I ran into an old friend named Wynn Handman, who was the head of the American Place Theater for a long time, which did a lot of wonderful experimental work, and some of the very best actors around now sort of began work with him. We had become friends. Then Lowell had a play that was done there, and I was brought in to review it, and ended up being in a big fight with the New York Review of Books about my review and things. I had fairly close relations with Wynn, who's a very good guy and very, very bright. He's a wonderful teacher. And he said, "Why don't you make? We'd like you to make a play for us." And I said, "You know, I've tried making plays. They're terrible. I'm never going to do that again." He said, "But look, what are you working on?" I told him about this. He said, "Can't you make that into a stage piece?" So that's what I tried to do, and he cast it, and he got. For the director, he got Carl Weber, who had worked with Brecht for about 10 years. So we had a German director, but at least two-thirds of the cast and the crew were Jewish. And many of them very dedicated to Jewish, projects and aims. I thought they did a quite wonderful job on it. Although I should say this, they mounted it three times. The first time they mounted it, it was rather like a play, and it was all done in a single set. I felt rather pleased with it. The musician Richard Peasley, who's done an awful lot of stuff on Broadway. He wasn't. He says, "I don't think this does a service to the text." I was astonished. But as he talked a little more, I came to see, yeah, I think he's right. And they came to think he was right. So some months later, they end with a partly new cast because, people get hired and go off to Hollywood or disappear someplace. They did it the second time. This was very experimental. They had a Moog synthesizer and a percussionist right out on the front of the stage. Each of the parts might be taken by two or three actors who might move in and do things. There were microphones hidden on stage and speakers hidden in the auditorium, so you could never tell from what direction a voice might be coming at you or if it was coming. And this, I must say, fit with my thinking about the thing, because I thought of it not as being like a play but as like a sort of speech oratorio or something of that sort. And of course these people's voices were very good, and I had composed some choruses for them and things like this. And now they only did about maybe the first third of it this way. They got through it. And I was absolutely delighted with it. I thought this is wonderful. This is the way to do it. Because that's what it is. It isn't a play. It doesn't have the... I'm not very good at direct conflicts. This gets away from that. I mean, the conflicts here are all inside the people. You've got these guys who have done all these terrible things, and they know that they're going to have to stand trial, or that they're just going to be shot, or if they're lucky. Otherwise, they may get hanged or just ripped, limb from limb. So how do they react to this sense of their own guilt? Which they can not entirely ignore anymore. And it seems to me this worked just splendidly. But I was still teaching back here, so after that they had finished that part of it. I came back here and couldn't go in until they were fairly well into the third mounting of it. And there I saw something that the stage manager's girlfriend came over to me about that second thing, and it was later, I'm sorry, cancel that. I didn't say that. They now had broken the stage up into several little compartments and different rooms, and we're now doing it again rather like a play. And I protested violently, well, as loud as I can anyway,